mean, I have quilts about climate change. I have quilts about women's rights. And they're like, well, this shouldn't be in a quilt show, or this shouldn't be in an art show. I'm like, well, where should it be? You know, it has to be somewhere. We're not going to talk about this.
Oh, hello, friends. Welcome back. I'm really glad you're here. This week's conversation is super special. I had the pleasure of hanging out with Kathy Nida, who I'm sure many of you know is a visionary quilter and artist, and also turns out to be just like a wonderful human being that keeps it really real. Just really honest talk about what it's like to be an artist in today's world and to be someone that really cares about shaping a future that's better than our current reality, whether that's as an artist or a mother or a middle school science teacher, which Kathy also happens to be. So there's just a lot of really good grounding stuff in here for anybody that's undertaking the project of taking all the juicy, wild stuff inside of us and working with it, understanding it, transforming it, which Kathy does with her hands, with quilts, but I think all of us are called to do in our way. If you're not familiar with her work, Google it on up. I think what drew me to it when I first discovered her quilts was what I perceived to be this Kali Ma quality, a lot of fire energy, which is how I experience being alive a lot of the time, and also this incredible tenderness of what it means to be human and to experience the world in a human vessel. It's so meaningful when you find artists that reflect back to you what have been previously private experiences. And I think that's really sacred work, to feel seen by another being that we don't know in this way through their creations. And I obviously have a real big soft spot for anybody in whatever medium that is pulling down into this dimension these kind of talismans of our shared experience. That's magic, and that's a really special way to devote a human life, which we are all absolutely capable of. So let's do this thing. Here is the lovely Kathy Nida.
Well, you know, it's Martin Luther King Jr. Day. This is why I have the day off, and I'm watching a lot of people post, you know, the normal quotes and everything, and I'm like, that's not good enough. Mm-hmm. I've been doing quilts on COVID lately, and then I did one on childbirth because I have a request for a show coming up. But I have these ideas for how to do an anti-racist quilt, but I'm not, you know, I'm trying to talk to other white people, and I don't know how to talk to them. And so that's kind of, my head is just constantly trying to figure out, what does that story look like? What does the story look like between what I know and understand and believe versus what the reality is for an actual person of color versus the people that I know who are like, this is not a problem. You know, mm-hmm. All lives matter. What's wrong with what happened at the Capitol? I'm like, oh my God, what? And so there's a story there for me to tell them, but I don't know how to say it to them in a way that makes sense to them. And so that's hard. There's a translation issue. You know, I've just got so much in my head, especially today. You know, it's like, what do you say? And I don't, I'm probably not going to say anything. I'm just going to go donate some money somewhere. Mm-hmm. I don't know where, you know, and it won't be enough. And it won't, and I'm reading an indigenous book at the moment, indigenous history of the U.S. And I always knew we messed that up, but I didn't know how badly. Mm. And so, like, cause we don't teach it, you know? And so, like, all those things are in my head today because it's a really, you know, that is why we have this day off. So mm-hmm. Anyway, it's so complicated.
Yeah. Thank you for your just honesty about that, because I absolutely resonate with that. And are you talking about speaking to white people that are sort of the ones that think that what happened at the Capitol is okay? Or are you interested in the people that are just posting the MLK quote and, like, checking the I did my thing box?
Well, both. The thing is, I'm not sure the former will pay any attention. They tend to be the ones that look at my work and go, oh, God. and get angry and report me to Fox News or whatever. And so maybe it is like the people in between, like, you know, sometimes my mom, I'm like, woman, what are you saying? Mm-hmm. You know, you're the one who raised me. But it's, you know, I know there's a spectrum. You know, I have a great grandparent who was KKK. And so then my grandmother had some beliefs growing up that came from that I just used to get into huge arguments with her as a teenager. And then, you know, then my mom, just as she ages, there's some fear. And I'm like, that's not, and, you know, I know where it comes from. I can see where it comes from, but I don't know how to speak to it.
Hmm.
So somewhere, I don't think that the people that stormed the Capitol and actually, you know, did violence, I don't think I can say anything to them. I don't know what to say to them. But I have people I work with who are, you know, I think they're somewhere on the spectrum where maybe I could say something to them. I just don't know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
So
anyway. It's funny because I have a friend who just had his first child in the past couple weeks, and it's a girl, and we were texting a bit, and he was saying how watching his wife give birth, he was like, I was terrified and I would have gone to the hospital in 2 seconds. And she and her doula were like, we got this. It's fine.
Dude, chill out.
Yeah. And he was like, how does this happen that boys come out of women and then somehow, like, where does patriarchy start? How is this possible? And I was like, great question.
I know. I've been asking that one for a really long time. Same deal. Yeah, there is that. The strong versus the weak. I was watching Netflix has a show, The History of Swear Words, and pussy was the one we watched last night. And it's like, you know, why are you calling weak men pussies when that's the thing that pushes a baby out? Man, dude, your balls are the weakest things out there. it's just this weird world we're in because that's the thing. The indigenous history is talking about a matriarchal history, you know, that was taken over by this patriarchy and destroyed everything that they had. And it's like, yeah, I don't really understand it. I'm on the wrong side of it, I think, to understand it. But I want to try to understand it and try to get other people, you know, that whole thing. I don't know how to explain to you why you should care about people, man.
Right.
I just don't know how to do it.
If I have to explain it, you probably won't get it. Yeah.
Well, they're not going to listen to me, unfortunately, and I'd really like them to. So there's a way to tell that story, and maybe it's not going to be my first try. Maybe it's going to be my 10th or 12th try. So,
well, I feel like you're onto something by communicating through your art. I mean, I think that's the way. If you do reach people, it's through the heart space. It's through their emotions.
Right. Even when their emotions are somewhat angry,
yeah.
I'm probably still talking to them in some way, shape, or form. But yeah. Yep, that's working on it my whole life.
So has making art and quilting, has that felt like an intentionally rebellious space for you?
You know, people have told me that I'm rebelling there, and I'm like, I'm just communicating, y'all. You know, people have told me that, oh, you put vulvas and uteruses in there to offend people and boobs. And I'm like, no, I just do it because that's what we have. Like, I come out of an art background. I actually have an art degree, and we painted nudes and drew nudes, and this is how you come into the world. Why are you thinking this is a horrible thing? So, you know, if you live in Europe, it's not like this. I mean, there are still some people, not like here, though. We're so set on our ways, we can't even look at something and go, oh, look, that's where a baby came out of, or anything like that. So I'm not trying to rebel so much as, I mean, maybe I was when I was younger, so much as y'all need to look at things a little differently. You need to try and open your minds up to the possibility that, you know, I don't know. To me, a naked person is like, this is the core of who we are, especially when I show the insides of bodies. You know, I'm really not... You know, I'm a science teacher. I look at the insides and the outsides, and they all work together, and it doesn't, to me, there's no, oh my God, you can't look at that. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, sometimes people look at the, you know, I mean, I have quilts about climate change. I have quilts about women's rights, and they're like, well, this shouldn't be in a quilt show, or this shouldn't be in an art show. I'm like, well, where should it be? You know, it has to be somewhere. We're not going to talk about this. And that's that, especially the quilt world. The quilt world is really insular about, oh no, we don't want this in our world. So I mean, there's plenty of people that do like my work, but there's a lot of there's places I'm not allowed to show work anymore, and I'm like, okay, whatever.
Because people don't want to have hard conversations.
They don't want to have conversations at all. They want it to be pretty. And I don't, you know, somebody yesterday texted me and said, your work is so disturbing, but I love it. And I'm like, is it disturbing? You know, to me, it's just, it's what comes out of my head. So maybe that's the problem right there. But I mean, some of them sure have disturbing things in them because disturbing things happen. And it's like, you know, like I said, I just think of these as stories I'm telling or, you know, things I'm thinking about. But I don't know. To me, like the one I'm doing right now about childbirth, I'm like, that's not disturbing. Mm-hmm. That is what happens, you know. A baby comes out, there is blood, the vulva is there, you know, there it hurts. Mm-hmm. You know, why is this disturbing? This is what it is. Mm-hmm. So I'm not trying to rebel against the world. Well, okay, maybe I am. I don't know.
I mean, there are definitely some institutions that need some rebelling against tonight. I mean, it's funny because when I look at your art, I feel like it's like I experience it as a ceremony almost, like the way especially that you map these bodies kind of onto the physical landscape and the natural world just feels so like it's like, thank goodness for that depiction.
Well, and that's how I see them. It's, I don't know how, even know why I see. I mean, if you look back at work I did before I was a science teacher, there was still some of that in there. People are like, why don't you put clothes on them? I'm like, well, sometimes I do, but the clothes are their own message. And maybe I'm trying to have the message be, you know, people in general and not this specific person who's wearing a skirt and a tank top or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it's not like I'm going out of my way to go, oh, here's a nude. It's just that the clothes have a message that I'm not looking at. I'm looking at something deeper than that, I think.
Man, that makes my heart hurt for our culture that we've gotten so down the rabbit hole that naked bodies are so scary to us.
Oh, I know. Well, you know, it's it goes back a long way, I think. But yeah, it certainly hasn't gotten any better recently. So, you know, normally I would be entering a whole bunch of shows, but like with COVID, it's like it's almost like, well, they're not going to have the show open anyway. Why? I'm really in this place where I'm like, why should I even enter, you know? But I know I will, because I like to have my work get out there, and I get enough positive stuff out of it that I think people like to go look at them. But there's been a lot of negative in the last, you know, 5 or so years. And and you get tired of fighting it. You just get tired of saying to people, really, that's what you saw? Mm. You didn't see, you know, I don't know. It gets frustrating. Mm. And I really should stop listening to those people and just listen to the ones who are like, wow, that's cool. That's great. Or what were you thinking here? Or this really resonated with me because of this. And I'm going, wow, I didn't even think that when I made it. Mm-hmm. Those are the conversations I really like to have when people are like, oh, I see this, this, and this. And I'm like, cool. And they're like, were you thinking that? I'm like, well, first of all, I probably don't remember because when I do the drawings, I'm not always consciously thinking I'm going to put this because of that. I'm going to put this because of that. I'm just looking for more of a, what am I trying to say in general? And can I make it say that? Mm-hmm. And that's why this anti-racism, whatever it is, that's, you know, it's less about the what am I trying to say and more about how am I saying it in a way that people that maybe wouldn't normally look at my stuff and go, cool. And I don't need them to say cool. I need them to say, oh. And some sort of conversation to happen in their head and maybe with people. It doesn't even have to be with me. I just want them to go, oh, I never thought of it that way. Taking that and putting it into imagery is difficult. Mm. So,
yeah, you're bringing something from the subconscious up to the level of consciousness where it can be dealt with in our world.
Right. And that's already problematic. Get a lot of more people doing mindfulness meditation before we can get there.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're not there yet. So
what is your relationship like to your body? Were you raised to feel like you were powerful?
Yes and no. You know, my parents were pretty good about, you know, girls can do anything. And there were always those instances of, you know, I remember the neighbor dad down the street commenting on me having to wear a bra and just going, and so you have these things like women having to wear bras. And I love now that my daughter's like, yeah, no, fuck those. And I'm like, that is exactly how I, if I could get away with that at school, I totally, you know, so there's some that I've come to accept more about my body as I age. And certainly when I listen to my daughter, talk about body things. She's in her early 20s, and she's actually doing her own podcast. And sometimes she talks about stuff like pregnancy and stuff, and I just laugh because and it's not that I'm laughing at her. It's like, I'm like, oh, honey, you're going to have to go with your body on this one. Mm. But I'm in a very much different place. I very much accept where my body's at. There are times when I fought it like crazy. Mm. Like I look at, one of the reasons I started doing so many drawings and then quilts of women is like, you're just ruled by your uterus, or it feels that way for the longest time. You know, you're either trying to get pregnant, trying not to get pregnant, trying to deal with bleeding, trying not to deal with bleeding. And it's just like, it's so frustrating. And then all of a sudden you don't have to deal with it at all. Hmm. And I'm like, whoa, that's mad. And then you can look back at it and go, okay, well, you know, cause I teach sex ed to 12-year-olds as well.
Wow.
And so I know. And they're like, this isn't fair. How come we have to have this and boys don't? And I'm like, oh, honey, there is no fair. But I said, the thing is, you're looking at it like that. And I get that the bleeding is a pain in the butt and the cramps and all. I understand that. But that moment, if you decide to have children, like that moment when you do give birth is just one of the most amazing things ever. You know, and I had really bad pregnancies, but like the actual birth moment was just like, holy crap, I made that. And like, I create stuff all the time, but like, you know, it's nothing like creating the totally independent minded children that I've apparently produced. So, but it was hard. You know, I was born in the 60s. There were lots of things where girls had to do this, girls had to do that. I remember a job, one of my first jobs, that they were like, you have to wear pantyhose. And I actually got a doctor's note to say I was allergic to them. So I wouldn't have.
Amazing.
I know. And I tell my daughter that, she's like, what are pantyhose? Exactly. So it's just, you know, what my experience with it versus, say, society's experience with it. There's so many jobs where it's obviously been, you're a woman, so you can't, or you shouldn't, or shut up, or you're a bitch because you say something. And that's been hard. Mm-hmm. Because I don't think that's gotten any better. Well, I mean, it has since the 60s, my mom will tell you, but, it's still funny because I listened to my mom and she lived through the 60s in a different way than I did, but like, she's completely anti-feminism. But she raised me, so it doesn't really make sense to me, but like, just, I guess the rants of the feminist of the age, she just didn't like. But if you say to her, what can women do? She'll say, oh, women can do whatever they want. They just need to set their minds to it, which isn't always true, which I've told her. But, you know, it's just, it's weird that she rejects the concept of it, but in reality taught her kids, that that's, you know, how we should believe. So,
wow.
Yeah. Well, that's another one. How do I get her to see that? I don't know, man. She's my mom. You can't get moms to see anything they don't want to see. Come on.
That's the golden rule. Yeah. So how do you see what's happening now with all the unrest? Because I feel like I hear people say like 2020 was such a crazy year, or nobody's ever been through what we're going through now. And I sometimes I'm like, yo, people have been through like empires falling, right, and ice, right, ages. Like,
well, a lot of my students are refugees from the Middle East. And so, you know, when people are like, oh, my God, they lost 6 months of school, I'm like, dude, my students lost 4 years of school because they were bombing schools, and they're still okay. Mm. They're behind, sure, but some of the ones that work hard are catching up, and the other ones were trying to get to catch up. But, like, there's sometimes things that are more important than what else is going on. But, sure, I mean, we've had pandemics before. You know, if you're talking in terms of, like, people's rights, for God's sakes, the 60s is a great example of all that unrest and everything. And I think people are scared of that. They don't want to go back to that. I don't think it's done.
Yeah.
We're not done with the pandemic. This is going to continue. We're going to be dealing with this for possibly years. And then in terms of unrest, in terms of political unrest, we're not done. I'm actually terrified to teach on Inauguration Day because I think something bad is going to happen, and I'm going to have all these 12-year-olds in my classroom and trying to manage their feelings and emotions when I'm like, you know, I was hiking when the Capitol when those insurgencies were happening, and I came back and I'm like, the boyfriend turned the news on. I'm like, what the hell is that? And I'm on the phone with my mom. I'm like, holy crap, they're taking over the Capitol. She goes, what? You know, I'm like, what happened? Did I come out of an alternate universe?
Right.
But it's not. It's not an alternate universe. This is people that are unhappy, that don't like what's happened, and using the internet to like fuel your, I'm like, where's your evidence? And of course it's on the internet, but some crazy person said it, or some person who doesn't necessarily look at all the evidence kind of thing. It's just, I don't think we're done. I think we're going to have more stuff. And if we don't end up in some sort of civil war, I'm going to be surprised. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would be easy to think, okay, well, Biden and Harris are in, cool. We're going to reverse all the environmental stuff. We're going to reverse all the human rights stuff, and it'll be fine. It'll be beautiful in 100 days. But the people that voted for all that are still here, and they still feel like they're not getting what they want. And I understand where they're at because I spent the last 4 years with that. Mm. But, you know, I don't know how to help them see that what they thought they wanted isn't, I don't exactly know if what they think they want is an all white U.S. that only helps white people, then that's not okay. You know, like that's the thing with that whole indigenous history. You go back and look and the history of slavery and I'm like, do you people not know what really happened? And that's back to that MLK thing. Oh, look, here we have a quote about love and hate. Okay, but we've totally whitewashed his entire history as well. And there's a lot of violence and anger in everybody. And the group that thinks it's okay to take guns in and handcuffs, and what were they going to do? That's what I don't understand. It's like, were you going to take Pelosi hostage or shooter or what? You know, were you going to rape and pillage like our ancestors did? Or is that where we're at right now? Mm-hmm. So I don't trust humans not to do that again. I mean, we keep doing it. Why would we not just keep doing it? Mm-hmm. I would hope there's enough of us, but I don't know. Maybe there aren't. You know, I can't assume that all 70 some million that voted for Trump this time around feel that way. Mm-hmm. But a chunk of them do. And that's the chunk we need to worry about and have conversations with. And those are the conversations, again, I don't know how to start those. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, hi, I love you. You're a white person. Put the gun down.
Yeah.
Yes, I make quilts about boobs. You like boobs, don't you? You know, I mean, just like, I don't know how to have this conversation because I know in real life, those are people that I shouldn't say they are people I don't talk to. I have people at work that I know believe some of these things. And I don't always know how to talk to them either. Mm-hmm. I just try to talk to them from a place of respect, and we don't ever talk politics. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's just hard. It's hard to know what to do next. And I think a lot of people are struggling with that. How do we not have the angry conversations with like family members or friends? Mm-hmm. How do you have a logical, it doesn't even have to be logical. I'm not the most logical person in the world. A caring, empathetic conversation, even sympathetic, that moves all of us towards a world that's better for everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a lot of friends right now that are starting families and having their first babies. And I think a lot like, whoa, what are you asking that child to take on? But maybe that's just what it means to like create another human at all. I don't know. What is it like for you to be a parent in this world?
Well, I raised smart kids. So I can only hope that they're out there in some way, shape, or form, and however they do that, like my daughter's much more vocal about it, and trying to make things better. Mm. And I actually joke with some of my friends. I have a lot of friends that are complete geeks, very much into, you know, into trying to make the world a better place, but they decided not to have children, which is their decision. And legit, having kids is not an easy thing. But I'm like, yeah, but like, you know, I always tell them the stupid people are having lots of babies, man. You got to help us out here, yeah. Which it's not really, that's not really how it should work. But as a teacher, I certainly, and I don't impart my politics. I try to teach critical thinking, you know, okay, well, what's the evidence that you have for that? Like when we used to teach climate change, okay, what's your evidence for that? Okay. So what's the counter argument for that? You know, cause parents would, you know, they're 12-year-olds. They come to us with what their parents think, mm-hmm. or what they've seen on the internet. And so, you know, I've had to counteract the flat earthers. I've had to counteract the science deniers. You know, I've had to counteract the, when I used to teach geologic time, you know, the God makes everything. And I'm like, well, I'm not teaching religion. You get that in history. So let's look at the science of it. Well, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, but we're looking at the science. What is your evidence of that? Well, God says, okay, what is your evidence? And so there's a lot of that. Like, as I think that's the one thing I can do as a teacher is just try to get them to look at, there are multiple sides to things. And there is, you need to look for the evidence of things. Like, where's your proof that things happened? And look in more than one place. You know, Wikipedia isn't necessarily the go-to on this, though it might be better than some places. But, you know, I know my kids are smart, and they think, both me and their dad made them think. And they read a lot, and they look for alternate explanations for things. And so as a parent, I think that's the only thing I could have done was to bring them into the world and have them contribute in some way, whatever that looks like. Mm-hmm. Hopefully if enough people do that, and I'm not sure they are, then we can, you know, this has been a really rough time period for, I remember saying 4 or 5, actually a little longer than that, maybe 8 years ago, that there was a conspiracy against women. And a very smart male friend of mine was like, no, you're imagining it, you know? And then they start passing all these laws about birth control and abortions and stuff. And I'm like, look, and he's like, no, you're imagining it. That's not, the liberals will come in and fix all that. And I'm like, really? Cause I haven't seen that change, you know? And I love that, you know, our government has got so many more women in it now, with all the protesting that was happening, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. I love that. And I hope that continues. And we see more people of color and more variety in Congress and the Senate, I think is going to help with all that. Mm-hmm. But we have to keep pushing for that. Mm-hmm. And we're fighting people that are, you know, that are believing that somehow that's destroying their way of life. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, but that's, your way of life was borrowed on other people's, you know, time and lives and land. This is not our land, you know. Mm-hmm. No. Did you think there was no one here when us white folks showed up? I don't know, because I used to teach in a school that was largely indigenous, and even they would be like, oh no, I'm not going to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and I had never thought about it. See, and that's where that whole white privilege thing's in. You're going, I never thought about it. I don't like the pledge because it has the under God part in it. And I'm like, yeah, but I don't roll that way. But that was added later, you know? And so when these kids would be like, I don't say the pledge and this is why, it's not my country. And I'm like, oh, well, you know, that makes sense. You don't have to say it. I just needed somebody to say it to me. And I think sometimes, you know, I've had people say, oh, it's unpatriotic not to say it. And I'm like, really? What is patriotism then? What is believing in your country? And why do you tell me I have to leave my country because I don't think the same way you do? I don't. That's not what this country was founded on. Even if you ignore the whole Native American part of this country, you know, the part where we came in and took over everything, we didn't found it on, you know, not questioning anything. They were here because they were questioning things. So. But even that's problematic because we shouldn't have been here in the first place. And if we were here, we should have been nicer about it and, you know, bought land and whatever. And we didn't do that because we didn't know how to do that. We just like to take things over. So
I have a friend in Connecticut, this medicine man named Oso, and he was talking about the story that he's from the Nahuatlacas people in Mexico, and he said that they believed that the way that you got rid of bad spirits was to trap them in jars and then seal the jars with gold and then bury them. Oh. So when the conquistadors came, they dug up all of these pots and stole all the gold and released all of these bad spirits. And I was like, that is the perfect story.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That. Because they wouldn't even have cared about that part.
Yeah. And here we are living amongst all of these spirits of greed and selfishness. And yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, and they kind of brought it with them too. So like, yes. That's double.
Yes.
That's like doubling it. Yeah. This history I'm reading does deal with this, with Mexico and the Aztecs and the Mayans and conquistadors as well. Because, you know, you can't look at the U.S. as a country without all the land that's attached to it. you know, we drew these weird lines and they don't necessarily match up to historical lines at all. So it's the way we deal with land and think of land versus older civilizations, they just thought of land as a totally different thing. And we have this thing, this need to own, to have a piece that we can put a fence around that, which, you know, I feel the same way. It's like my neighbors need to be over there, man. They just need to be away from me. But maybe if I had different neighbors, I wouldn't feel that way. Maybe it would be more of a village kind of thing.
Right.
That sounds nice. It does. I wish that it could be like, I read something about a bunch of old women. I can't remember where, in the UK or somewhere in Europe, that all their husbands had died or disappeared and or divorced or whatever. And they all just moved into this big community and they take care of each other. And I'm like, wow, that's kind of cool. I could do. Yeah. I mean, that would be an easier way to take care of kids. It would be an easier way to take care of sick people. Your pets, you know, if you just had a community like that. And I know some people do where they live, and it's not that I don't like my neighbors. They're nice enough. The small children I could do without, but see, there we go. That's just me and screaming. It's fine. But, you know, we teach our kids, oh yes, you know, the most important thing you can do is get a job and own a house and have children and get married. And I'm like, I don't know that that's true. I haven't done any of that particularly well. So
yeah.
we should stop giving kids those messages and say, you know, the best thing you could do is find something to do that you love and be happy with it. And ideally, if you like being with other people, you know, find some to be happy with. And then, you know, if it would make you happy to have children and to raise them to, you know, add to the universe, then you should do that. And if it doesn't, then you shouldn't do it, you know, that whole kind of thing. We have these achievements that are also materialistically based that, and I was raised with those too. You know, I was told, you know, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this. And, I guess my art is me fighting it the whole time, but
yeah.
I don't know. Because I do. I have a normal job and I, you know, have two children. I am divorced, but I have the house and the car and stuff. And then I was at an art gathering that was online this weekend and somebody's like, do you ever sleep? And I'm like, my smartass answer is no, but I do. I mean, I do sleep. I get a good 6 hours a night, but it's so important to me to have that hour to 3 hours in the afternoon after work when I can make something that... I feel empty when I don't. Like, I feel empty when I'm not creating something. And I can't just make a pretty landscape. I mean, I've done a few in my time, but there was one quilt that I made. It was for a public building, and so it had to have no nudity in it. So I did one of my women, Earth Mothers, and I covered her with animals and plants. And it's a beautiful quilt, and it sold. So, you know, success all around. But when I look at it, I'm like, eh. Because it's like, it doesn't have any resonance to me. And so I made another one where there were nude parts showing and there's a homeless woman in it. And there's more depth to it to me. And it sold as well. So I feel pretty good about that. But, you know, I mean, not that like, if I were basing all of my good feelings on things selling, I would not be happy. But it's strange how much better I felt making the piece and posting the piece when the one that was pretty got, you know, a million more likes. And why don't you make quilts like this all the time? Jeez. And I'm like, well, fuck you.
Sorry, I'm over here just telling the truth.
Sorry. You're right. There's a homeless woman in her rib cage. What do we want me to do? Because that's reality. That's what's really there. That if she's an earth mother, that's what's really in the earth. That's what's happening. So, yeah, it's always an issue. I know some people, they just want me to make pretty stuff and stuff that's cheaper so I can buy it. And I'm like, well, you know what? I'm just going to make what I make over here. And if it works for you, that's cool. If it doesn't, I'm good with that. So
sometimes I think too that so many people are trying to consume things, whether that's other people's art or, you know, literal eating or shopping. And it's like, if they would actually sit down and try to channel what's actually happening inside of them, like, those people wouldn't be saying that to you, you know?
Well, no. And those are the people I think that, like, there are some people I'm like, what do you do when you go home? They're like, oh, I watch some TV. And I'm like, that's it? You just watch TV? And they're like, well, yeah, I might read a book. And then I go to bed. And I'm like, oh. Well, so here's how I get so much work done. I do read books, but I read them while I'm doing something else, like I'm on the bike, or I know, which is, I'm probably should be healthier about that, or while I'm eating my lunch. And then, you know, I make myself get off the couch, you know, mm-hmm. I might watch part of a show, I get off the couch, and then I go make art. Mm-hmm. And that's why I get so much done. And so it's not that I don't sleep, it's that I use my time differently than you do. And which I'm totally okay with you not doing. It just confuses me.
Yeah. Yeah. Because like, I need it for my mental health.
Right. I mean, whether it's, you know, meditating or dancing or crocheting, you know, maybe you crochet while you watch TV or something, or you're drawing, or like you don't, you're sitting there complaining about how you never get any work done. Well, stop watching so much TV, mm-hmm. or do it while you watch TV. I do that sometimes. Mm-hmm. I don't pay very close attention, but I do it. Mm-hmm. You have to decide what's important to you. And if it's important to you to make art, then make art. Mm-hmm. It's obviously very important to me. And I have a lot of friends I went to art school with and they stopped making. And I'm like, I don't know how you do that. Because to me, this is my sanity. This is my mental health. This is my meditative space. And so if I don't do that, then I feel like I haven't done anything. And they're like, you're a teacher. Of course you've done something. I'm like, oh man, teaching is so frustrating that I need something that I can succeed at.
Oh man, that's real talk. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, there's days where I'm like, well, y'all turned it in blank. That's great. Thanks very much. I'm going to go off and draw something. I mean, and I love my students. I really do. And sometimes they are so amazing, but there's a lot of frustration that comes with this job. And it is a job that does something. And so, you know, I've been in jobs where it was like you came home and you didn't have to worry about it afterwards, which is nice. But I never felt like I was doing something. So I think even with my day job, I have to have something that makes me feel like I'm contributing or doing something.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, do you think the people that stopped making art were kind of lost focus on using it as a mental health tool and got frustrated by trying to play like the art world game?
Yeah. And like, what do you do with it once you've made it?
Yeah.
Like, it's interesting because the one woman that I went to college with, she's an amazing artist, an amazing painter, and her husband is a photographer and does collage art. And he has continued making work, but he never shows any of it. They just have piles of it in the closet, but he still makes it. And she complains about it. I'm like, dude, he's making it.
Yeah.
I'm like, you get so frustrated and you're like, I should go back to doing this and I should go back to doing that. And then you have a million excuses as to why you don't do it. And that's the thing. When you're in school, they're like, here's your assignment. It's due in 3 weeks or it's due in 2 days and you have to do it. And so when you get out of that situation, if you're going to actually continue to be an artist, if it matters to you, then you're going to find a way to give yourself that level of whatever it is, you know, even if it's you only make 2 pieces a year, or, you know, you're like your husband and you make it and you put it in the closet. You don't have to make it for people to see it. I happen to enjoy that. I don't want to be around when they see it. But it's always so complicated, you know, but I like hearing about it afterwards. But I'm not necessarily making it for people to see it. I'm making it for me, but it's cool when they do see it. But,
yes.
You know, I think a lot of those people, they came out of art school and they thought it was going to be some magical, oh, you're going to get all these invitations. And I'm like, no, you have to go out there and work your butt off for X number of years. And even then, you know, the invitations might be few and far between. Mm-hmm. I get more now, certainly, than when I was, you know, I started quilting when I was 23. And I'm still doing it 30 years later. Well, now I'm getting invitations. That's how long it takes, mm-hmm. you know. Well, some people get them earlier, but they make prettier stuff than I do. So, mm-hmm. But yeah, I don't know that they ever got what I got out of it, or they don't have the motivation, and which is too bad. I've tried to give the one friend of mine some of that motivation. But she's stuck in her head about what she wants to do, and there's only one way to do it, and you can't do that right now. And I'm like, you need nude models, you have to pay them. And she goes, well, I don't have the money. And I'm like, well, then you need to think of something else to do.
Right.
You know, I don't know what to tell you about that. So, you know, she's stuck in her head on a lot of different things in terms of making her art. And so mm-hmm. for me, I just kept, I kept doing it and I kept doing it. And there were times when it was hard, when I had little kids, where it was really hard to get anything done. And then when they got older, you know, they just accepted that that was part of who their mom was. Mm. They might not have always liked it. I remember my daughter saying, you can't hang them in the living room. You can't. And I'm like, okay. And so I put them in the entryway because they're naked bodies. She'd bring her friends over and she's like, they're naked bodies. And I'm like, they have naked bodies. You know, what are they going home and complaining to their parents about it? Because no parent ever called me, man. But I get being embarrassed when you're a kid about that stuff. That's understandable. Mm. But they survived.
No, I think the people that I love most are the ones that were like raised around whatever kind of weirdness and just have accepted that being human is weird. Right. That's good.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm always amazed when I go into, like, where I would go pick my daughter up from somewhere and I'd walk in this house and there was no art on the walls. There was nothing. Mm. There were no rugs. There were no photographs, even of family. It was just white walls. And I'm like looking around going, okay, this creeps me out. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know I have a lot of stuff and you don't have to have a lot, but like something, you know, mm-hmm. Oh, we have a mirror. I'm like, okay, well that freaks me out. I don't know what to do about that. So, but people are raised differently, I guess.
It's interesting that you're saying that the quilts are, you know, a mental health thing for you, because I've experienced grief in some of them, which makes me wonder if you're, yeah, that just must be processing time, whether it's grief or other emotions. Is that what's happening when you're making them?
Sometimes, yeah. I remember I went through a really bad breakup. And it wasn't even my divorce. That was another one. But for a while, my quilts were very sad and very angry. And at one point in time, probably 3-4 years later, I drew something that didn't have a woman crying. And one of my friends texted me, she goes, oh my God, you just drew something that doesn't have tears. And I went, wait, what? Did I? I mean, I didn't even notice. I just went, oh, you're right. I did. Oh, that's kind of interesting. So there is a lot of personal processing that goes on in some of them, whether, you know, it's processing about stuff that's happening in the world, or, you know, some of them are more personal stories, even though they seem to be a general comment on stuff. So yeah, for me mentally, they are definitely a way to get shit that's in my head out, whatever that is. And it's a form of counseling for me. I mean, I've been in counseling as well, but for me, this is a way to get it out of my system kind of thing. And then it's on the fabric and I'm like, oh, okay, it's over there. It's kind of like with meditation. They tell you, you know, whatever emotions you're feeling or whatever crazy stuff, you know, you just sit there and you watch it and it kind of drives by and you're like, oh, look, it's over there. That's much easier for me to deal with when it's on the quilt, I think.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
gets it out of my head anyway. Mm. So
I wonder if you have any perspective for people that are feeling paralyzed by what's happening in the world right now or by their emotions.
Oh God. Yeah, it's whatever works for them. It's like I go out and I hike. And I think that, like, when I'm feeling really frustrated and, like, just, like, I don't know what to do, I just, like, okay, we're out of here. Let's put the boots on. Let's get out. Mm. Before I'm ever even able to draw or anything. But, like, whatever they do that makes them feel better, if it's, you know, I have a group of friends they're reading books about women from the 1900s or something. Mm. Because they're these strong female characters, in many cases, that but it's, you know, it's away from this kind of thing. And I'm like, yeah, my book club keeps reading dystopian with, like, you know, pandemics in them. I'm like, you guys need to stop. We need something that's more fantasy, for God's sake, because you do need some separation from it. Don't ignore it. Don't. I'm like, people are like off of social. I'm going off social media. I'm not going to watch the news. And I'm like, I don't know that you can totally do that. Mm-hmm. I think we still need to be informed and have a clue of what's going on. But you also need to give yourself some space. And so if that's, you know, if you can't, if you're an artist or a musician or whatever, and you can't do whatever you do, then, you know, start small, for gosh sakes, you know, like knit a potholder, you know, just like whatever, because that is a meditative process, you know, plant some vegetables, you know, whatever it is, walk the dog, bathe the dog. The dog would probably appreciate that. You know, buy somebody's pattern and stitch it up. You know, you don't always have to be making something that's brand new. And I think a lot of times when I'm really close to something, I can't do that. Like, I need to be away from it a little bit before I can go, okay, now I can make a quilt about people storming the Capitol or whatever it is, you know? Or I did one quilt about gun violence in schools, and it took me the longest time to draw it. And it wasn't until we did one more of our lockdown drills, you know, where I have to fit 36 kids behind a desk and they have to be totally quiet. You know, 36, 12-year-olds, some of them are adult size and they don't know how to be quiet. And some of them smell bad, man. They really do. And we're all in this tiny little space and, you know, some are giggling and I'm like, you know, just pointing at them because that's all you can do, you know? And it wasn't until I got done with that I could come home and draw what it felt like to be the only adult in that room thinking of, you know, what if a gunman comes in that window? Because that's what we think about when they have these lockdown drills. And they even brought a company out to have us evaluate our space. And I'm like, God, you know, as an adult, I can't handle this. Mm-hmm. My refugee kids really can't. But it took that for me to be able to process it. But I think just any sort of small, something you can do that feels successful, like baking bread, you know? Mm-hmm. Okay, don't start with sourdough. But... you know, whatever it is, you know, make dessert for your family, you know, whatever, because I think that we have to give our brains time to deal with things, you know, whether it's, I have a friend whose mom just died of COVID. And like, I know she's going to need months to deal with this. Just because I know what kind of person she is. And, you know, she had just started crafting again. And I'm like, I'm just going to go buy her some craft supplies. Mm. I'm just going to go, because I think she needs that. I think she needs to have something that she can put some energy into that will be positive and she can succeed at, to be able to process the emotions she's going through. So mm-hmm. The more that, like, those of us who know how that stuff works, even if it's like calling up a friend and say, get your mask, we're going for a hike. I think the better off we will be.
I love that. Yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah. I want to ask you more about the teenagers too. Like because I don't know, it's, the world is so surreal when you're a teenager in the way it's like anything could be real. And yet also, I don't know, kids are so adaptable, but how are they holding the potential of crisis?
Some of them do really well. It's interesting because, well, some of them, I think their parents really shelter them from some of the news. But some of them are fully aware of everything that's going on and they bring it to the classroom. Mm-hmm. And it can be really difficult some days to trying to manage the emotions of a bunch of kids. And some of them don't care. They're like, where's my next video game? I need to get on that. And, you know, such and such was released last night. You know, right. That's all I'm thinking about. And then you have kids that are terrified. You know, I just got a new student in distance learning whose dad has had COVID for 10 days now and is not getting any better. And it's like, you know, I don't know how to talk to, I mean, my dad has COVID right now, but he doesn't have any symptoms. So we're good, you know, as long as that continues. But, so, you know, when you have that little bit of information that you know a kid's coming in with that, then, you know, you just try and say something that you think might be supportive. And I'm sure I screw it up sometimes. I'm sure I say things because I don't always think about what I'm saying. And then, you know, I just apologize, but they tell you, they're very honest about shit. Cool. they don't hold it back. It's not always what you want to hear. you know, my first warm-up question coming back was, what's on your mind and why? Because I just wanted to see if any of them were coming back with thoughts about the Capitol. And most of them, honestly, were like, sleep. Sleep is on my mind. And so I could probably ask that question again this week, and I would get a very different answer. I got into trouble, I don't know, 3 years ago or something. We always have anti-bullying week, and sometimes it's handled better than others. But we're supposed to make a poster to decorate your door. And I'm like, God, I hate these projects. And I'm always very open with, okay, what do you guys want to do? And they're like, well, You know, I threw out some ideas. You know, we could, you know, put some bullying statements out there and show what an anti-bullying would look like. You could draw some pictures. And somebody very quietly, a kid who rarely talks, said, "I think Trump's a bully." Wow. And I didn't say a word. And all of a sudden, my entire class, and in that homeroom, there was one white kid who was not Middle Eastern. Everybody else was either a person of color, an immigrant, or a refugee. And they're all throwing this, they're throwing quotes out. They're like, "Yeah, blah, Trump, blah, Trump." And I'm like, "All right, well, so what would that look like?" You know, I didn't say, "No, you can't do that." And so we made an anti-Trump poster, basically, because he is a bully. And the kids would put up quotes, and then they would write what you should say or do instead of that.
Wow.
And I thought it was amazing. And so I put it up on the door. And there was a drawing of Trump, one of the kids did. And, oh, man, did I get in trouble for that. And my principal was he's very good. He was like, I know that it's right, but I have complaints. And the people that complained, the adults that complained, because it wasn't kids, it was adults, it was teachers and staff, they said that I'm the one that gave them the idea. And I'm like, to my principal, I'm like, I didn't give them an idea. I never do that. I literally just stood there and they did it all. He goes, "I know that." And I said, "Then why are you asking me to take it down?" And he's like, you know, political, blah, 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 because he's the principal. He has to say that. Mm. But, you know, I know those people think that I told my kids what to do. And I don't have to. And that's where I look at that and I'm like, oh, see, there's my hope for the future right there.
Yeah.
A bunch of 12-year-olds who like think that Trump's a bully, man. I didn't have to say a word. I didn't have to do anything except, okay, well, what does that look like? But, you know, sometimes the assumptions that other people have that we're going in there and telling kids things. Well, no, good teachers aren't doing that. They're letting kids figure stuff out and they just keep asking questions like, what does that look like? Where's your evidence? You know, that kind of stuff. So kids are smarter than we give them credit for. They're often lazy. and 12-year-olds honestly have a lot of growing to do. You know, their prefrontal cortex is not fully working yet. But a lot of my kids will come back when they're in high school or they get into college. And then I'm like, "Oh, see, I knew you could grow up." So 7th grade is not the easiest year in the world, that's for sure. But I see incredible hope in them on a regular basis. I worry about a lot of them, about the situations they're in and what they're dealing with. And sometimes they tell me what they're dealing with. And certainly the kids that aren't showing up right now, a lot of them are because there's a lot of family stuff going on that normally when they were in school, we would be able to protect them a little bit from, and we can't do that. And that's the hardest thing to look at when you say, "Oh, well, you know, this kid never comes to school." Well, you know, there's probably a reason for it. And I can't do anything about that reason. And honestly, if they were in my classroom, I might not be able to do anything about it either, but I would at least have a chance of it.
How many kids do you have? Are you teaching at one time?
I currently have 177 students, which is more than I usually have. But I think they think because I'm online, I can just have unlimited numbers. So normally I just teach science. I teach 7th grade science, which I love. And this year I'm teaching two sessions of art to 6th graders and 8th graders, which I've never taught, three different subjects essentially with all three grade levels. So, and I have to tell you, I don't know who thought it was a good idea to put me in charge of 6th graders. Middle school teachers are different than elementary school teachers. We're generally more sarcastic and a little bit more hard-ass than elementary. I don't have any cute sweaters, man. I wear a lot of black. And that's fine. They're not all like that. Some of them are very still cutesy, whatever. But 6th graders are this strange creature that came out of elementary school, and they still need so much caring. And their parents are so protective. And I'm like, chillax. Your kid is fine. They're 11, for God's sake, you know, which is, when by the time they get to 7th grade, there's a lot more, oh, yeah, totally. So it's a hard age to teach, but I really appreciate over the years some of the insights that I've gotten from these little monsters. And I know they're going to, most of them are going to grow up and be decent human beings that ideally got something out of class, even if it was, you know, the world's not flat.
Goodness.
Or how to actually, you know, check a YouTuber's veracity. That would be another point. If that's all they learned from me, we're good. You know?
What are the takeaways you want have kids to have about art when you're teaching art?
Teaching art is hard. I try to tell them that, like, you guys aren't born knowing how to do this. And they're like, well, you're really good at it. I'm like, I've had 53 years of practice. Mm-hmm. Like, do you think I drew like this when I was your age? And I was trying to find some of my drawings from when I was their age. I found a couple and I just forgot to show them. I should totally make them a slideshow because some of them are pretty bad. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I look at them now and I'm like, oh, well, I actually drew better when I was younger than I did when I was their age. Because you start to look at your work much more critically. But the kids that are turning stuff in and that actually listen to instruction and don't just do whatever they want, they do pretty well. I'm impressed by their ability. Like the sixth graders, they're sitting there complaining about trying to do this digital thing. And I'm like, I don't know how to do that. You guys figure it out. That's what Google's for. And one kid will come back and he'll explain it to all of them. And it's just like this cooperative experience that brings me joy. It's hard to teach art. I'm not a fan. Mm-hmm. I didn't really get a choice in the matter. Mm. Kudos to the actual art teacher, and it would be a lot easier if I were doing it in person. But we work with what we have.
Yeah. Was there a point in your journey with formal education that you were kind of like, appreciate the tools, but I'm going to now make, you know, my own vision?
Well, I make quilts, man. So I went to UC Irvine and I got a degree in art, studio art. I also have a degree in comparative literature. So you can see I'm totally teaching what I normally would. Right. But I did a lot of ceramics and a lot of photography. Mm-hmm. When I was in college, I painted, but I don't really like painting. I'm not very good at it. I liked the ceramics a lot, but I kept, you know, blowing things up in the kiln kind of thing. Because when I went to Britain for a year on education abroad, and they do all the, you know, the standard, the real art. So we did life drawing and printmaking, which I actually really like printmaking, but it's an expensive and difficult habit to have at home. And there was some craft center in this tiny little town. And a friend of mine was like, hey, I'm going to go take this class in weaving or batik. I did all the craft classes they had. And my mom taught me to sew when I was like 8 and embroider soon after that. So I've always had this sort of calling towards fabric and thread, I think. And like, I went to these classes and I'm like, oh my God, this is what I love. And of course I go back to the art department and the dean, you know, Britain is very traditional, are like, well, those aren't art. Those are craft. I mean, you can do them, but they're not art. They'll never be art. And I always sort of kept that in my mind. And I continued to try to do printmaking when I came back here and got out of college, which is hard to do without a studio setup. And I walked into some store that I hadn't seen before, and there were quilt classes. And I'm like, well, that looks cool. That's fabric. Oh, I'd like to try that. And like from there, all of a sudden, my brain was like, yes, the textural quality of it, the tactile quality of it, the patterns of fabric, it screamed at me. So there was no, I mean, I kept doing screen printing until my kids were born. And then there was no way that you could pull a screen, print the whole thing, and then clean it. I didn't have time. Like the baby would be like, I need to nurse now. And these are toxic chemicals. And I'm like, okay, I can't do this anymore. And so I slowly took what I was doing with that and went into the fabric. and I don't think I've ever looked back, you know, fabric. There's just something about it that talks to me. Mm-hmm. And I can create in it in ways that I can't create in other materials and other media. Though I am trying painting again right now. I don't know why. But we'll see how that goes. I'm kind of drawing with paint, so it's different. But I do like to experiment in other things just to see if it's something that will stick. But I've been doing this kind of stuff for a really long time and I really like it. So when another thing I tell my students, they're like, I suck at this. I'm like, don't say you suck at it. You're just not good at it yet. You know, and you may decide that this isn't something you ever want to do. Like, which one of the things we're doing makes you feel more joy? Do more of that. You know, and you can tell, like, you know, with some kids, they're like, no, I love this. No, I love that. No, I hate all of it. Because some kids are in my art class because there was nowhere else to put them. Not because they want to be in art. And I'm like, I understand what you're saying. and I want you to try. You know, that's all I can ask of you is that you try. I mean, I tell them, I said, I feel the same way about math, y'all. But I still need it. You know, maybe you don't need art in the future. But that's the other thing I always tell them. You don't know what you're going to be doing in your future. Like, if you'd asked me in middle school what I would be doing now, it certainly would not have been teaching science.
Right.
I don't know what I thought I would have been doing, but it would have been more on the art spectrum, I think. And in the end, I kind of fell into this job. It's not the first job I had. It probably won't be the last, but the art has always been my first job as far as I'm concerned, even though nobody's really paying me for it. So,
you didn't take on like a career in that sense and something else. You were like, I'm going to do a thing that can pay my bills, but it's not like I'm here for the quilts.
Well, you know, the thing is, I was in art school, but they never really explained how do you get a job in art after this. And like, I have friends now, a friend of mine teaches up at one of the local community colleges, and it's a gallery management class. And I'm like, holy shit, if I'd known about that, that might, you know, or museum studies, like I might have gone that direction if I'd had the chance, but my degree program didn't offer anything like that. And it's true that at that age, I might have gone, no, I don't want to do that. I don't know what. I mean, I got out of school and I needed to get a job because I needed money. And so I went to a temp agency, and then I started working, ended up working a lot in editing type stuff, which I'm good at. And that's actually my third side job is copy editing. Every year I copy edit a book or two to give me some extra cash. And it's probable that when I retire from teaching that I will continue to do that because I'm good at it and I can do it quickly. But, you know, the art isn't ever going to pay the bills. And even copy editing, it's questionable whether it would pay the bills. And so, yeah, I just kind of rolled through a bunch of jobs. And then I was losing one of the copy editing jobs because they were shutting, post 9/11, they were shutting a bunch of publishing houses down. And they were like, you either have to come in and work full time, which I couldn't because my kids were still little, or we're just going to stop giving you work. And so I was like, well, I want some extra money. So I was considering becoming a park ranger, like, you know, national park ranger, but that would have
we would have had
to move to do that. And I thought about becoming a vet, and I'm like, no, then I'll just bring all the animals home. And then I was like, well, I could be a teacher because I could sub. Like, I have family members in the past. You know, my mom was a teacher for a while. My grandparents were teachers. You know, it sounds really easy. You're like, oh, I could just be a sub. You know, no big deal. I know stuff. And then I ended up getting divorced in the middle of that. And so I had to have a job. And so that's when I went into teaching. And I've been doing it ever since. And, you know, nobody ever does teaching for the money, that's for sure.
Right.
It does not pay enough for the hours we put in. And that's the hard part, is the balance between the number of hours I put into my job because I care about it versus the number of hours I put into my other job, art, because I care about it. And there's always a balancing act there. That I never really feel successful about, but certainly if I were like, you know, a grocery store worker, well, I'd be in a pretty dangerous situation right now. But if I had a job where I didn't have to bring it home with me every night, I often think that would be better. But, you know, I know that I'm doing some good. Back to that, I feel like I need to be contributing something to the world, and this is how I do it.
Was accepting that your art might not ever, you know, fully pay the bills, was that an emotional thing, or were you able to find value other places pretty easily?
I don't really worry about it. I don't make it for that. I make it because I need to make it. It's like my blog, you know. I don't write that for people that read it. I write it for me.
Yeah.
It's like a historical documentation. There's a lot of words in there. But like, I know that when I'm having a really hard time, I can go back and read January from, you know, 4 years ago and go, oh, it was worse then. We're good. Or, oh, I have this feeling every year when it's almost spring break or whatever. So, that's helpful to me. But so making the art was never for a career. It was never for making enough to live off of. It's nice when I get money for it. It's nice to have recognition, but I would still keep doing it if nobody ever paid attention to me, because for a long time they didn't. So it was, you know, I spent a goodly portion of the first, you know, 15 years of making art where nobody even, and I have one friend, she's like, she made her first quilt and it became famous right away. And I'm like looking at her going, what the fuck? You've only been doing this for 3 years. Like, some of us have been in this for a while, honey. You know, and there's some jealousy there. And then I'm like, eh, whatever, you know, it's fine. I'm good. So yeah, I make it for me. I do. I would still make it even if nobody saw it. So I'm like the husband shoving it in his closet, except I do actually send it out there. So,
well, as somebody that has appreciated them, I'm glad that you do that and that you have devoted the space in your life to answering that. And yeah, I'm really, really grateful.
Thank you. I'm also grateful for it. It helps my head, so there's that.
If you want to find Kathy, she is online, kathynida.com, and she's also on Instagram at knida. You can find me there as well at marajames.com and marajames on Instagram. I hope you're taking care of yourselves and giving yourself space to be tender, soft, and human. I know this world pushes us to put up a lot of armor, and you deserve to put that down and take a rest too. So I hope you're finding spaces where it's safe to do that. I love you, and we'll be back soon. But so